Another Chicago Sky season has been in the books for a couple of weeks. Certainly not what it was the previous 2 years where the team was competing for a championship. This time, a much different-looking group was able to crack in the playoffs but didn't have much for the Aces. Here to talk about the Sky this past season and what might be ahead for the future here on 9 Good Minutes, Subria Whitaker of Grow the Game. Subria, how are you today?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing wonderful. Subria, let's just get right to the Sky season that has just completed. What is it about this year, obviously one of change, that stood out to you? What are your main takeaways from the Sky over the previous couple months?
So, I mean, obviously we had a lot of different things going on, right? A coaching change, essentially a brand new team, losing a lot of our core players that were able to propel us for the championship and then trying to repeat the previous season. So I think it's a lot of growing pains, but I'm really impressed with the way the team handled it for the most part. I think they were very cohesive just from a little bit of comments toward media, you know, with sticking up for Courtney, Elizabeth Williams being very vocal, and Kalia Copper kind of having her moment of realization that she is the leader that the team needs. So although it wasn't the best season or the one that we were hoping for, I think it had a lot of lessons, and I'm really excited to see how they take this camaraderie that they've built and, you know, in facing all of the adversity that they did this season. And so that, along with a new ownership, right, with D. Wade, and then a new coach and a WNBA legend and Hall of Famer, Teresa Weatherspoon, I'm really excited for next season.
Let's go ahead and start with Teresa Weatherspoon. You're talking about a big name in the WNBA, coming from the NBA, has extensive coaching experience in the men's and the women's game. What do you think immediately she'll be able to add to this Sky team here in 2024?
I mean, just the fact that we have a stable, you know, coach this year. So obviously when we lost Coach Wade, we had an interim coach and there was a lot of uncertainty around, you know, his future with the team and what the staff looks like. So I think just having essentially a new staff after this forced rebuild, I think will really, really help instill confidence and faith back in, you know, the front office and the coaching staff as far as the players are concerned. And so I think it's actually coming at a great time. Having a new team, new ownership, and a new coach, I think that's really what the team is missing. And so having someone that can speak to her time in the WNBA is always going to be a plus when we're talking about coaching. So they have coaching experience and playing experience in the league. I'm sure she's going to be able to really get the fire going in our players and give them what they feel like they're missing. And so hopefully having, you know, healthy players in Rebecca Gardner, if she stays, and then Izzy, I think we're going to see it all gel, hopefully, and come together in time for the start of next season.
You know, Subria mentioned it, talking about Dwayne Wade. What do you think he adds? And obviously the star power that he has, the Chicago connection, what is he going to bring to the franchise now as he joins the ownership group?
First and foremost, a lot of conversation that we've already had, you know, with everyone talking about ownership. We saw the Las Vegas Aces and the New York Liberty in the finals. And there's no coincidence that these are teams that have recently acquired new owners and owners that are willing to invest heavily with practice facilities and things like that. So the Sky have already been having conversations about a practice facility that's not so far away from Wintrust. And I'm not really sure where they are with that process, but just having someone who also played, you know, at the professional level and knows what the team needs, and maybe his ability to bring on new owners, if that's a possibility, but whether it's owners or sponsors, I think having that star power, and like you said, someone that is familiar with the Chicago community, both with, you know, the short time on the Bulls, but, you know, growing up here, and just having the resources and the network and the connections that he has, as well as the new coach, I'm sure they are going to start investing a lot more heavily in all the things that the players need and, you know, the fan experience as well. And I think as, you know, the players start to get, you know, more involved in those conversations with what they need and they're improving their relationship with the organization, I think fans will come as well. And we can hopefully see some growth in all areas.
I'm curious, we take a look at the roster. Obviously, the Sky dealt away a lot of first-round picks coming up here. When taking a look at the roster and trying to build up the team to try to take another step next year, what are some of the key areas you think that they need to address moving forward for 2024?
So we have a lot of guards, and I know a lot of people have had, you know, conversations about that and figuring out who's our first option, who's the second option, who's working well, who's gelling. I think we also need a big. Elizabeth Williams did a great job, you know, with protecting the paint and, you know, a block shots are her thing. But I think getting someone else to help her in the paint and, you know, adding defense, since we kind of missed that a lot with Rebecca Gardner's absence this season, and maybe figuring out the game plan around, you know, the guard combinations and who's really going to be taking the shots, who's really going to be facilitating. I think once they get that figured out, whether it's having conversations with the current teams or bringing someone else in, like potentially a Skylar Diggins-Smith, I think if they can do that and maybe get a big, like a Kalani Brown, I think we'd be in great position. And, you know, like you said, and like a lot of people have said, this is not the same team, right? We don't have a Emma Meesman, we don't have a Candace Parker, and we lost a veteran in Sloot and Quigley. But if you look at the success of the Las Vegas Aces this season and last season, where people always talked about, well, they don't have a bench, but they did have a bench, and your bench is what you make it. You don't necessarily need all the all-stars or former WNBA champions in the world, as long as you have a leader like we are seeing Ka grow into, you have raw talent, and you have people who are willing to buy into the system and play their role, I think we will be fine. And I think we can make another run for the postseason and end a lot, you know, farther than we did this season, and maybe even win another championship.
One person who is remaining from the championship team of 2021, that is Kalia Copper. This was the first year where she was the going away star of the Sky. I'm curious what you saw out of her in that role here in 2023, and maybe what she can continue to add now that she has a new contract here in 2024 and beyond.
Yes, I think it was a little shaky for, you know, Kalia. I think being the main leader, not just as, you know, a veteran and former finals MVP, but essentially the person who has been here the longest, you know, once we lost probably our OG leaders, you know, in Sloot, Quigley, and then, you know, someone who obviously commands, you know, leadership and respect like Candace Parker. I think she had to figure it out. And I don't think it was really easy to find her voice without, you know, the guidance of other players. That she's now the player that a lot of people are looking to for guidance. So I think she understands that now. And I think she's going to take that with her and, you know, hopefully have some conversations, you know, with Candace and, you know, our new coach and Teresa and other legends who've had to lead teams before and really figure who she is as a leader and what her leadership style is. And then also being able to build relationships with these players. A lot of them didn't play before, and I won't say just meeting because I'm sure, you know, they've met and play overseas. But now that we know a big group of who's re-signing, they have this time in the offseason, you know, if possible, between their overseas commitments to have those conversations and become a closer group. And so I think she's going to be, again, okay, now that she has the guidance, she has time to build relationships, I think she's really going to step into that. And hopefully, as she embraces it, the city embraces it, and the team embraces it, we can really see the Chicago Sky.
Subria, obviously, we look around the league globally, and the big story was the Las Vegas Aces. They win the championship, the first repeat champion since the 2002 Los Angeles Sparks. I'm curious, along with the Aces, what other storylines really stood out to you in the WNBA this past season?
I mean, some unfortunate ones, you know, being De'Erica Hamby, and then eventually Skylar Diggins-Smith and her absence from Phoenix and the way that they've kind of handled media since then and where she's going. So I know that she's absolutely a topic of conversation, and seeing not only where she lands, but the way that Phoenix will be able to move forward now that they have a new ownership group and they just recently announced a coach that has you know, created a lot of conversation around being the new highest paid coach in WNBA history without any women's basketball coaching experience. So, you know, outside of Skylar and Phoenix and seeing, you know, how they play out and going their separate ways, I think obviously people are now going to talk about what is New York going to do. Right now that they've lost, they essentially formed this super team to try to beat Las Vegas, and they came up short. And we see that a lot of one-year contracts, like, you know, Stewie is signed. Where's JJ going to go? A lot of players, like Maureen also talked about in her exit interview, that she will be with her national team next year. So looking at prioritization and, you know, players deciding not to come back, I think those are the key storylines looking towards next season and might really shake things up.
Sabria, one last question. Let's talk about Grow the Game. What has gone on this year? What might be ahead for you guys? Just curious, because obviously those who are following on this one, along with you on social media, interested what's going on with that effort.
Yes. So Grow the Game, for those who may not know, is a nonprofit organization committed to increasing awareness, attendance, involvement, and engagement with women's sports. And so this year we had the pleasure of working with the Chicago Sky again on some of their, you know, theme night efforts, including HBCU game night and the D9 group that attended that game. So we're going to be working with them again this offseason to see how we might be able to support their efforts and their fan engagement and outreach for next season with selling tickets, as well as continuing our relationship with DePaul Women's Basketball and having the conversations with them about hosting another Grow the Game night. But we've also been able to have conversations with the league and other WNBA teams about potentially working with them to assist them as well. So we have a lot in store as we start to rebuild and, you know, prepare ourselves for the new tasks ahead and, you know, developing and becoming an even bigger organization to make an even bigger impact.
We're excited to see that, Sabria, along to see with what the Sky will do with Teresa Weatherspoon in charge and, of course, their off-season moves, whichever ones they may end up making. Sabria, thank you so much for joining us here on 9 Good Minutes to talk about the Chicago Sky.
Thanks for having me.